Okay, good morning. Hello, everybody. It's my great pleasure to introduce Conor McBride of Strathclyde University to you. I'm sure you know him from his work on dependently typed programming, such as, for example, his work on the epigram language and ornaments in ACTA, and kind of trying to shoehorn dependently typed programming in the ever extending but not quite sufficient list of type extensions in GLC. Conor.
Okay, thank you. It's really delightful to be here and to hang out with old friends in their natural habitat. Thanks for coming out. Let me start with a little monadic puzzle. We know that the state monad on a given type S of states is something that's kind of goes from types to types, and we're used to having a couple of operations. Let's see if I can get this right. Not what I'm writing, but I'm trying to get right. It's what I'm leaving out. Right. So the put operation would take something of type S, and it would give us ST of something in the unit type, right? You say what the new state ought to be, and you get a response, fine. Okay, we also expect to have a get operation, and there we're expecting something of just a type, ST and S. Okay, so that's to say you issue get and it gives you a computation that returns the value of the current state. But there are lots of implementations of this interface. I mean, the very same interface could be used just for communication on a bidirectional channel that transmits and receives S's. There's nothing here that says this is definitely, whatever you do to implement this interface, it has to behave like state. So, being a dependently typed programmer, I wonder what I might do about that. Okay, well, I know a thing or two, but why don't I, instead of just using types, use types indexed by the value of the current state? It's a nice thought. Then at least the types can sort of talk about the correctness of the operations with respect to the current state. Okay, so what do I need to know? I need to know what it means to be a monad on index types. So let's have a little tutorial about that. You know, start with a digression and then digress from it. Will I ever actually give this talk? And okay, so let's suppose we've got some M that goes from I to I to star, where I stands for index, any old thing. Well, what does it mean that for M to be a monad? Well, the right thing we need to do before we can answer that question is to figure out what category we're in. So the objects are going to be things that live in I arrow star. So rather than just sets, there'll be sets that depend on some index. So we have to figure out what are the morphisms. So if x and y live in I arrow star,
what is, I'm going to write x funny arrow, this thing is going to be a set of morphisms from x to y, but what is it? It's going to be the set of, so x and y are kind of like, if you think of them, put them through the Curry Howard lens, they're predicates on I. And then a suitable notion of morphism would be predicate inclusion, like whenever x holds, y also holds. So we can write that down. That's for all I in I, whenever x of I holds, y of I also holds. Okay, so this thing is some kind of predicate transformer, and the morphisms we care about are predicate inclusions, and now we know what category we're working in, we can just use the same old definition of what a monad is. Okay? So there's going to be a thing which I'll call return, and that's going to take an x to an m of x in the, with the appropriate notion of morphism. And just for kicks, I'm going to give the other operation as the Kleisley composition. So far. I've seen people. Is there a line above below which I should not go?
Basically, return for me.
But you can imagine. So you read return?
I can read it if I.
Yeah, crane. But the point is that if you know what return usually is,
yeah,
you already know what it says.
Yeah.
So, nothing has changed except I've got a funny little dot above the arrows saying that we're using the appropriate notion of morphism for this. For this category. Now, before you think, goodness me, isn't it terribly strange to have operations which look exactly like the operations we're used to? Then, you know, things are going to get even stranger. Because what's really going on is that M is some kind of predicate transformer, and the first thing, this IRO star thing, is like a goal state, and this thing, this index, is the state we start from. So the idea is that M captures some notion of reachability. It's the type of strategies for achieving a goal starting from an initial state. So the type of return says, if our goal already holds, then we can achieve in the initial state, right? These arrows talk about what's true in a given state. If our goal already holds, then we can achieve our goal by doing nothing. And then the composition says, if we know that we can always achieve Y when X holds, and we know that we can always achieve Z from a state when Y holds, then we can achieve a state, say, a goal Z from any state where X holds, by just chaining these things together. And if, so these, the arrows in this category, in the Kleisley category, these things that go from X to M of Y are really talking about if a precondition holds, there is a way to achieve a postcondition. And what I've written down then is nothing new or strange. It's like, welcome back to the 60s and 70s. I've just written down the rules for skip and semicolon in Hoare logic. Funnily enough, right, what's going on there is that, you know, our fundamental Kleisley arrows are operations specified by a precondition and a postcondition. But of course, when I write star, I'm not really talking about propositions, I'm talking about sets, proof-relevant things, sort of data-carrying types, where we kind of combine the data we are interested in and the logic that we want to have about them, and that is the dependently typed way. So what if we get back to state? Can we turn this thing into into one of these things? And what happens if we do? Well, let's see. We now have to talk about, we have to abstract over the state we start in. I'm going to get fed up with doing everything multicolored. So we've got an initial state, and then whatever the operation is, we're going to end up in some final state, and then let's see if we can write down the specification, right? Someone is going to give us a particular new state, which I'll call S hat. And then what should the post condition be? What do we want to say about? What's our goal?
SF.
Well, yeah, so S, so we have to explain what, in terms of S prime, the state we end up in afterwards, what should be true?
S prime is this S.
Yes. So we're going to get, the data component we're going to get is still in the unit type, but we're going to get back a proof that S prime is S hat. Okay, so put is the easy one. Let's figure out what to do about get. Sure, we know our starting state. What's our goal? We're going to be given back an element of S. We might have opinions about which element of S we would like.
Which was previously stored, so it's prime.
Yeah. So we're going to get some S check, and we want to know some things about it. We're pretty sure, well, it's not going to behave like get unless we're really going to get back the state that it was, the current state, right? So we're going to want S check to be equal to S. But we also want to make sure that get doesn't do some kind of Heisenberg bad stuff. We have some opinions about what S prime ought to be. We kind of like S prime also to be equal to S. Okay, so great. We managed to write down the appropriate Hoare logic specification for put and get to make the state monad on S and a monad on sets indexed by states. There's no way you can implement this interface without really implementing the state behavior. There's just one tiny little problem.
You have to keep the state around yourself.
In order to get the state, you must already know it. Man, that's a bummer. What on earth are we going to do about that? What's the missing ingredient? This thing, we realized this was kind of Hoare logic translated into modern dependently typed programming. What did the Hoare logic people do about it? Well, they had this idea that not every variable that you talk about in a Hoare logic specification is an actual program variable. They have these notions of ghost variable that stand for things that specifications are allowed to talk about, but are definitely not around at runtime. And indeed, quite often the post condition is that some program variable is equal to some ghost variable. And if the ghost variables are accessible at runtime, it's really quite easy to discharge that proof obligation with an assignment. So we need some way of separating the things which are ghostly from the things which are actual. So let's have a think about that. Let's have some labels. I'm going to write a little asterisk for ghost and a little blob for program. This is like these things live in heaven and these things live on earth. So let's figure out what we're playing at. So the key move is to decide that the state which must be respected by the operations, by the clies, the arrows, is known only in heaven. That's to say, whatever you do, you get this evidence, this X thing at runtime, you get this Y thing at runtime, and you have to convince the type checker that you are respecting the current state without knowing the state at runtime. So that's the game. Then correspondingly, hooray, these things have to be in heaven. And so what we're really saying is, you don't need already to know the state at runtime. We're just making sure that whatever happens at runtime agrees with whatever the type checker is modeling the current state as being. And then we get something useful. These, in the case of put, right, if you're really going to update the state at runtime, then you're going to have to give the new state at runtime. Yeah. That one's on Earth. And then, so you notice that we're forming a proposition here between a heavenly variable and an earthly variable. So somehow that has to be okay. We probably like them to be the same type if we're going to form that proposition. But hopefully, we have propositions, right? We probably don't want them on Earth. So we probably want to make sure that somehow it'd be fine if propositions might as well exist in heaven. Fine if information could flow from Earth to heaven. That's to say, God's watching us. I gave this talk once. Xavier Leroy was in the audience. He said, "Conor, I worry for you. Your metaphors, they all used to be about the Marxism. How have you got religion now?" he has a point. On the get side, again, the point is that we are going to get back an actual runtime value and a promise that the get operation is telling us the truth about what should statically be going on. So this is a picture. This idea that things belonging not necessarily all in the same place, and that there's some notion of restricted information flow that might matter, but that we still want to be talking about the same types of stuff. That's to say that the kind of runtime static distinction has nothing whatsoever to do with what type of stuff things are. If you were in Brisbane, I mentioned Milner's coincidence, where the distinction of between terms and types is lined up with the distinction between things which are that live at runtime and things which live only statically. And here we have a clear situation where it kills us, right? because we want perfectly respectable value-like things to live only at the type level. But similarly, if you're in the world of dependently typed programming, you'll struggle to find a dependently typed language that will give you honestly something which behaves like, you know, this separation between earth and heaven. You just get told, you know, basically you're just programming in heaven, and everything has to hang around. Certainly the Agda compiler, the Agda notion of irrelevance certainly isn't this, because when you have irrelevant data in Agda, you are not allowed to compute with it, even in a type. It really has to be completely irrelevant to all aspects of what's going on. Idris isn't there yet, at least with explaining what's going on. There's some kind of voodoo behind the scenes and some attempt to infer what's going on, but nothing that surfaces nicely in some theory, and that's always the way with Edwin. it's an understanding that he and I have. He'll just, you know, shop in my shop whenever the right product is ready. So that's fine. So this sort of situation is really necessary. And we're not getting it in the dependently typed languages because there's no sense of quantifiers which are properly type level only. And we're not getting it in Haskell because there's no sense of being able to quantify over values which exist at runtime but can leak up to the type level whenever you want them to. Essentially I have this sort of dual campaign to persuade Haskell to acquire proper Pi types, but also to persuade the dependently typed languages to have a proper for all that you can do erasure with. Much propaganda effort to be expended. Okay. So that's what I want to be able to do. I want to be able to do this in particular. But once you can start doing this, you might think, maybe there are other kinds of restricted information flow that might be interesting. And all sorts of reasons why you might care about information flow. I mean, you might indeed be some sort of spook who wants to ensure that that the government can see everything. Nearly spoiled the joke. That's always that you've got to set these things up properly. Right. Yes. What's the key property we expect if we're kind of doing gets and puts in this language where there's heaven and where there's earth? Is that, you know, we'd kind of hope that it's possible to generate runtime code in which none of the heavenly stuff is around. Right? That's to say, we want to get rid of everything here on up. And the idea kind of should be information doesn't flow downwards in the ordering. We should be, if we've got stuff that lives down here, we should be able to compute it, even if we get rid of all the stuff that's up here. So if we do have an information flow order that respects, that ensures that, you know, the government can see everything and then various levels of security below that, we will also have the erasure property that says we can just get on with our business even if we get rid of the government. So somehow So that's the nature of static checking, is that you type check, and then you erase, and then everyone behaves well, even though the high-ups are long gone. Okay, so how do we build systems, so type theories, which support these kinds of information flow anyway? I've got half an hour. So the plan is build a type theory that more or less does this, and then think about lots of, which is sort of parameterized by the information flow order we might care about, and then let's draw lots of fun little diagrams that model things we might care about. Okay, so pre-credit tease over. Let's do hard sums. So what order do I want to do these bits and pieces in? Right, let's first of all start, let's build a type theory and then refine it with some idea of information flow. And you can watch carefully for the spaces I attempt to remember to leave in the typing rules and try and guess what's going to end up in them. Okay. So, here's where Xavier is right to worry that I'm getting religion. I have a bit of serious religion at the moment, which is bidirectionality. All of these things. I rigorously separate the things which have their types synthesized and the things for which types must be proposed in advance. Okay, so these things, I call them terms, must have types proposed in advance. These things I call eliminations. We can synthesize types. So in particular, every elimination, the eliminations embed in the terms, right? If we can actually synthesize a type, we can surely check one. And on a whiteboard, but not on a computer, I mark the embedding with another line. Similarly, if you want to go the other way around, if you've got a term T that you, and you want to be able to synthesize its type, well, tough luck, you can't. So if you want to be able to get a type out, you better say what it is. So this is how you change direction between these two syntactic categories. The variables, which should have types explained somewhere in a context, are definitely synthesizable. And generally speaking, the elimination forms go here, which is why I call them eliminations. So in particular, function applications go here. And then all the introduction forms live at the top. So we'll have types, and we'll have dependent function types, and we'll have lambdas. And then there might be more stuff later. I'll start doing functions, and if we want to add more stuff later, we can. Okay. So then there will be two judgment forms, types go into terms, and types get synthesized from eliminations. And I'm religious about the retaining the left or right presentation of information flow. So here, this thing, the type comes first, and then we're checking that this term is okay with respect to it. So it has to be written this way around. So the fact that the set theoretic epsilon has is not, unlike the colon, reflectively symmetric is extremely useful. So yes, I have begun to say ni. recruiting knights. Okay, so let's have some rules. I also I write contexts only when I'm extending them, and I only write the extension. Just that saves an awful lot of faff. Right, so I'm going to be bad today, and say that the type is in type. I mean, we can if you really want to ramify the universes, we can do that later. That's not where we're focusing here. Okay, and then we can ask, how do we check that this is a valid function type? Well, we have to do it in a very particular order. We must first check that the domain is a valid type. And once we know that the domain is a valid type, we may consider a hypothetical element of that type, and not before. Under those circumstances, though, we may then check that the codomain is a valid type. Okay? So you can see information kind of flows round the rule from the sort of input stuff in the conclusion through the premises, and well, there will be output stuff on the other side. So we'll get there in a moment. Let's do lambda. How shall we check that a given lambda abstraction is accepted by a function type? Let me explain. The deal here in this judgment is that we assume the type is okay already, and that we're just checking the term. Let me, in fact, write a red box. Here's the red box. For this judgment, here's the red box. For that judgment, in the red box is the subject of the judgment. The thing that we're actually trying, that we don't yet trust that we're checking out. In these judgment forms, everything to the left of the red box we think of as an input, which should already be okay. Everything to the right of the red box we think of as an output that we better make sure is okay. So even when you're writing the rules down, you're kind of writing a bit of a type checker. So correspondingly, information flows round the rules from the inputs of the conclusion. Then you have to show you can construct the inputs of the premises, but you get handed the outputs of the premises, and then you have to build the outputs of the conclusion. So these rules are really a programming language for writing funny little monadic programs that that manufacture happiness. Okay. So those, we've got the introduction forms. Let's do the elimination forms. How do we synthesize a type?
Do you want some premises on that lambda rule?
Yes, I do. Sorry, no, I got carried away. Yes. So we're saying we trust this type to be okay already, which in particular means that both of its pieces must be okay. So it's all right to hypothesize an element of the domain, and then we can check the body of the lambda against the codomain. And you can also see why in this setup there is definitely no need for a type annotation on a lambda. We're only ever going to be type checking the lambda in a situation where there's a the domain is proposed for us, so we're going to be able to pick it up from somewhere else. So that's settles a particular running sore as far as I'm concerned. So okay, so let's move to type synthesis. How do we synthesize the type for this thing? Right, remember this thing is like currently untrusted. We've got a good candidate for what the type is going to be, right? but yeah, we've got to make sure it's okay. So yeah, we're going to check, first of all, that the type we are hoping to give back really is a type. And then we have to check that the term we propose really has that type. And then we can say, you're all right, you can have the type you're asking for. Okay. For variables, dead easy. So I write the back return style for look something up in the context. Right. If you can look up X of type S in the context, then no surprises that you can synthesize that very type for X. Okay. I'll do the other change of direction in a moment. Let's synthesize the type of an application. Here some care is required. So we've got something which looks like an application. The function is synthesizable, the argument is merely checkable. Do we have a choice? No choice about our first move whatsoever. We don't know at what type to check the S. So our only first move is to synthesize the type of the function. And it had better be a function type. Now, we said everything to the right of the red box had better be okay. So, assuming that the people who have delivered us this premise have done their job, this type is okay. Which means, in particular, that capital S is an acceptable type. So we can make sure that the inputs are okay for checking the argument. And now, let me just write square brackets x here to show explicitly how t may depend on x. Then we've got the question, what type do we synthesize for the whole thing? T of something. We might like to give back. So we've got a function that whose return type depends on its argument value. This x is free here, it's not free here, so we've got to do something with it. We might like to choose little s here, but we are not allowed to, because x lives in this syntactic category, and little s lives in this one. So, tough luck. Well, actually, secretly, good luck. We have to substitute the argument with its type, which fortunately we know. Okay, I forgot a rule up here, which is how do you check the thing that you get when you embed a synthesizable thing? Well, this is the lucky situation. First of all, you synthesize the type for the thing that you've got. And then, we need some relation to hold between S, and T. Here, if you're so inclined, is where you get to do subtyping. But I'm not inclined today, so I shall demand that S and T are equal on the nose. In fact, I can get away with demanding that they are equal up to alpha conversion. How am I doing? Okay. What I haven't told you yet, though, I mean, it's clear, especially when we do this, that computation can happen in types, and that's going to be important. So I'm missing a story about computation. I haven't told you what how computation works, and I'm also missing a story about how computation affects type checking in sentences. So let's fill in those blanks. There's one rule for computation in terms. It says that if you embed a term with a type annotation, then you don't need that type annotation anymore. And then the other rule we'd expect, given that we have lambdas and application, is a beta rule. Now, careful. There's a bit of a dead giveaway in the setup. Is this a valid elimination? Syntactically. Well, an application has to have an elimination in the function position, but lambda makes a term. This is not syntactically valid. What is syntactically valid and might provoke us to do something like computation is if we actually have a lambda with its type. So note, crucial thing, this being the change of direction from terms to eliminations, the only way we can write a redex in this language is if the thing which is being acted on is labeled with its type. So it is only this construct that allows us to write non-normal forms. The normal forms you get by exactly removing that from the syntax. So what we're saying is every active computation is labeled with the type at which it is active. And here, what we're doing is, when we replace an inert variable by some actual term that might kick off some computation, we're making sure that invariant, that every computation is labeled with the type at which it's happening, is being maintained. So this is a good thing, not a bad thing. You can still do open or closed computation in the empty context without type information. But in terms of open computation, small set computation, this behaves rather well. So what do we expect to get? I should have written T of X here. We're going to get, what do we expect to get? We expect to get little t with S in S. Is that syntactically valid? This left-hand side is an elimination. The right-hand side is a term. But also, what's going to happen that we do one step of application, but there might be more arguments, and this might be a function that actually there might be another lambda under here. So we have to acknowledge that we've done one step of computation, but this thing is still active at a smaller type. Meanwhile, by instantiating the bound variable, we've kicked off potentially lots of other computations, but again at a smaller type. So you can see what we're saying is we've got one computation at a big type kind of explodes into a bunch of smaller computations at smaller types. If it wasn't for this, a normalization proof would be really easy.
Okay, so that's how computation works. And then we need two rules, which I'll write on the left here, that explain how computation affects type checking. So here we have the rule which says you want to check type capital T, but maybe it hasn't computed to the shape you need it to be yet. Like, suppose T is a lambda. This rule says you really need the type that you're checking the lambda at to have computed to a pi type, to a function type. What if it hasn't done that yet? We might need to do a little bit of computation beforehand to get it into the form that we need. So we say, okay, T computes the R and R checks T, then that's fine. And then down here, suppose we are synthesizing the type for some E and we get back some S, but maybe S isn't as computed as we would like. For example, here, right, we might synthesize the type of a function and what we get back might not yet be a pi type. We might need to compute a bit more to get it into this form so that we can do the next application. Okay, that's fine. S computes to R, we can synthesize R instead. So when you go bidirectional in terms of the rules for the type system, you can also explain in which direction you need to be computing stuff. You need to compute types for you do forward computation before you check types, and you do forward computation after you synthesize types, and you never do backward computation. And the traditional conversion rule turns into this thing here, where you, before we invoke this rule, we could have computed T to any form we like. And then we invoke this rule, and this is going to say, well, actually, we synthesized the type for E, and then we computed it to whatever we like, and then they matched on the nose. So the conversion rule has disappeared. These two rules make the system no longer syntax directed, but once you've done your, well, once you've stratified your system and done your normalization proof, then you can adopt a kind of aggressive normalize everything as soon as possible strategy, and that redeterminizes the system. Okay, so that's a tutorial, 10 minutes to go, in how to build a type theory in a bidirectional style. Let's put the black pen away. I think with the red pen about worlds. We're going to have some type W, and we're going to have some pre-order on worlds. And the plan is that everything in the context, we will not only know what it is, we will know where it is. And similarly, everything that we're actually trying to construct, we will know where it is that we're trying to construct it. So if we go straight to the heart of the matter, if we're trying to construct a term using some variable x in world W, but the context tells us that X comes from world V, it had better be true that V is less than or equal to W. Okay, then let's do all the easy ones. So things like change of direction, that's not going to change the world we're working in. Now I should add, of course, there's a world there. I should put a world there. Box bigger. What else have we got? A bunch of boring rules. Some of the things we can tell. If we're building a function,
in some world, then the chances are we're going to want its output in that world, so we better make sure that the body lives in that world. And if we're doing an application in some world, then it's highly likely, similarly, that the function should be in that world. Right, but now we have to think. We have to think about two things. Firstly, we have to think about where types get built. Okay. So let's be non-committal about that. Let's say that there's an operation little star that goes from W to W that tells us, if we know the world we want to build a thing in, what world does its type live in? Okay, and now we can write down some rules. This would definitely better be in some star W. This would definitely be in some star W. This and that. Oh, and we're good here as well, actually. This is where it really kicks in, right? We're building this thing in W. T, definitely. Little t, you better live in W. Big T, better live in star. Okay, so that's one piece of thinking thought. The other thing we ought to think about is when you have a function, where its argument should come from. Right. We haven't got very many holes here, right? We've got, where are the holes? The holes are, we don't know what world this x is in, we don't know what world that x is in, and we don't know what world this s is in. And somehow they're all the same problem, right? So what goes here? Release candidate one. We just say what world we want the argument to live in. And it could be any old world, right? Interestingly, unless V is below W, the function will never get to see the argument. And it makes perfect sense to have such things. They're parametric. We know they're parametric. There's no way that this function can really make use of this argument. It's just there for type checking purposes under those circumstances. Okay, so we do that. Well, correspondingly, well, that immediately tells us that we stick V here. And then correspondingly, we better have V here. And because we check the actual argument in V, we better assume that the formal argument is in V. And then back here in the type formation rule, this X stands for a thing that is going to live in V. And oh, here's the question. Where does it go when we're forming the type? Does it go in star V or V? I can't remember. I think it actually just goes in. V. So there's going to have to be some careful arrangement that fixes that. I haven't told you what rules apply to these operations, but I realize it's that time. Why is this bad? It's okay. Some such system can be made to work, but it's bad because when I give a type to a function, I have to commit to exactly which world it gets its bits and pieces from, no matter which world it's being used in. So let's say I give the type of addition as taking numbers from the real world, and then I want to add that at the type level. The addition function might be able to move up to the type level because it comes from the real world, but its type says, still, I get my arguments from the real world. Can't add type level numbers. Rotten luck, you know, vector append out the window. And so that won't do. And there's another thing that's kind of bad. You know the multi-hole problem? Right. And you know, it sounds kind of pretty weird when you explain it with three doors. But if you explain it with 1,000 doors, right? Yeah, so Monty says, pick a door, and you know you're wrong with high probability. And then he opens 998 doors revealing goats and says, do you want to swap? I mean, you know you're wrong. Right. So imagine we're in this sort of situation where, let's say we've got the world of library things and the world of type level things. And then instead of having just one world in between, let's suppose we've got lots of them all able to access library stuff, all revealing themselves to the type checker, but not with their stuff in scope of each other. Possibly able to communicate with each other by side effects, but not just by variables being in scope. Does it really make sense to say, well, the type system allows us to, you know, forces us to talk explicitly about, you know, we can have a function which only works in this world. You know, I mean, if I want to have do a computation in this world, next door, I need to use a completely different function with a type that says we're allowed to use things from here instead of things from there. So somehow, that's the idea that we just use absolute worlds in the description of functions is pretty dangerous. So we're going to need some sort of relative notion of world. So, okay. Just give ourselves some notion of quantifier Q, and then what goes here is whatever Q does to W. So these quantifiers are going to be things that explain where to get arguments from relative to the world where you want the answer. So this is Q with some monotonic action on W. So there will be some other conditions which I don't have time to work through, but I've scribbled them all down on a piece of paper and proved a theorem, what's missing, what's missing. Here. Q here, QW there. So if you set this up correctly with Q interacting with the preorder appropriately, Q certainly has to be monotonic. There's actually another condition as well, which amounts to a kind of functoriality. Then you can prove what is clearly right, the vital admissible rule. Right? These are not rules of the typing system. Admissibly, this is just, you know, for the system to work, this has to be true, right? If at some world, you know that little t checks at big T, then, and you can get from that world to some other world, then little t better be okay there. Otherwise, we're in trouble. What we're really saying is, when you have this rule, how do you get stability by substitution? You've really got to respect this. Yeah, so that's the thing that you have to have. So it then becomes a matter of trying to prove this in order to discover the conditions that must hold on Q and W, and they turn out to be fairly sensible conditions. Okay, let me stop there, and I'm willing to discuss for as long as you want to hang around or not, but that's kind of where I've got to.
Thank you.
So generally, you sort of want the letters for your girls, so...
Sorry?
Do you want a lettuce or something?
Yes, well, don't let things be a lattice. I mean, so far...
Some kind of...
so far, the pre-order condition has been strong enough. We'll see whether more structure is necessary. It's clear, by the way, we should kind of get back to where we came in. With this thing, then we can, just to finish the picture, we said we wanted the worlds, earth and heaven, and we said we wanted quantifiers pi and for all. And now we can fill the operation in. If we're working on Earth and we're really doing relevant quantification argument on Earth, if we're working on heaven, in heaven, who cares? And if we're working, if we're quantifying irrelevantly, statically, then everything in heaven. Correspondingly, if we define plus with pi types for its inputs and then use it in heaven, the numbers will come from heaven. So this is an instance of this picture. This is the simplest picture that you could possibly have that makes the system worthwhile. Actually, not quite. I lied. There's a simpler picture. There's the picture which looks like this. And this is the familiar picture that we have when programming in Haskell. We've got two worlds, heaven and earth, but information flows in neither direction. So you have to use sort of singleton types acting as psychic media. I am a thing at runtime, but I am in contact with the spirit world. And my spirit partner has the same value as me. Where did the green pen end up? I disappeared the green pen.
It's in the spirit world, obviously.
Yes. So the idea you can erase the code from any upward closed set of worlds. So we're just used to performing this erasure. Actually, you can perform this erasure if you like. And take a Haskell program, rub out all the programs, you get perfectly sensible types. So what you have for this picture, if you start erasing things, is that, it doesn't have to be green, really, does it? That you could choose to erase this upwardly closed set, and you get just the code that computes here under library code. And you can do that for any of these worlds. So you can write a program which coordinates a bunch of whole, across a bunch of computational worlds. Oh, I find the green pen. And then do the erasure to generate the actual executable for each one, like taking an orchestral score and writing out the part for each player. So there's lots of possibilities, just drawing different sorts of diagrams like this that allow us to model all sorts of different situations. So I'm hoping what I'm really gunning for here is a general reusable theory of information flow in type systems, with the meta theory done once and a load of applications just by configuring the world topology differently. Essentially, the semantics of type theory is always done with Kripke models, because you have to model the idea that open execution happens in a context which is contains at least the stuff that where the term was defined. You might have substituted something under some binders, and now the context in which you're using it is bigger than the context it came from. So that obliges you to have a Kripke semantics that talks about future worlds in which things might get used. So the message there is, if you're going to have a Kripke semantics, you might as well have an interesting Kripke semantics.
When you were talking about all the different types of erasure you could possibly have, that reminded me of the type theory and color paper where they added colors to all the type theories and erased it, whatever they like.
Yeah.
So it feels like this sort of thing might be that might be an instance of this sort of thing.
It's not clear which way around it goes. We of course know that any old pre-order can be turned into a set inclusion order, their colors are being manipulated in terms of set inclusion.
Yeah.
I don't think they have quite the same story here about the quantifiers being actions on worlds rather than worlds themselves.
Right.
This kind of localization, which I think is necessary. But otherwise, they're very much cut from the same cloth. And I also expect that not only should you get an erasure for any upwardly closed set of worlds, you should also get a parametricity theorem. Yeah.
This seems to have a lot of parallels to untruncated objects and homotopy type theory, where Q would be a morphism in a higher... What's the exact relationship there?
I don't know, but I intend to find out. there's lots of stuff where the sort of ideas of nothing to see above such a level. So it could be that we can get a stronger handle on where the bits actually are in homotopy type theory by working in an information flow system. But I don't know. It's a whole other story that I'm beginning to work on the Strathclyde version of homotopy type theory. that was one of the reasons why I hope it wasn't too much of a kind of digression, but you can tell perhaps from the all of the kind of the thinking about how typing rules fit together, I've taken up the meta theory of meta theory as my new hobby, because there's just been this sort of explosion of type theories that have got the same kind of basic underlying stuff but are marked up in funny little ways to capture some extra aspect of what's going on. I could have filled this whiteboard in the same, I could rub out all the color, leave all the black and white stuff, and give a completely different talk about linear dependent type theory. And correspondingly, I want to prove type preservation once, goddammit! And I'm certainly working in that direction, and then what is the push out of all of these funny little ways to sort of model slightly more information? Can we get anything useful from it? Funny thing is, here what was important in the world structure was the pre-order structure. And in the linear type theory, what's important is a monoid structure. Monoids here, pre-orders there. Have we ever heard of anything that generalizes monoids and
tree over time.
Yeah. What if we just say category and get on with it? Well, one thing that happens is that there's more than one choice of morphism, so you need an annotation whenever you look at the variable. Apart from that, that's distinctly intriguing possibility. Definitely still more questions than answers.
Question. Otherwise, let's.
Beginning to wonder if I really need a semi-ring structure, or whether I might just need a monoid and an action on that monoid. Get a bit less. Perhaps. Okay, so so we have exactly the same sort of type system that we had downstairs. It's great to have done this warm up, except that contexts are going to show up in the rules again, because there's going to be weird scenes in contexts. And what's more, I'm going to have a little more structure for context. So first of all, let's let R be a semi-ring. And that's going to represent resources. If you think of it really as counting, the question that the thing we're modeling is, how many copies of a piece of information exist at runtime? That's the intuition. So then the thing that we traditionally call context, right, as with metavariable gamma, are now pre-contexts written with metavariable gamma. And there is a notion of a gamma context labels each X in S with some row in okay, so we have content DG, row, and S. That's what entries in a gamma context look like. Where this is so crucially, gamma contexts always have the same variables in the same order with the same times. The only thing that ever changes is the resource annotation that's attached to. Correspondingly, gamma contexts form R module. That's to say, there is a perfectly sensible notion of zero for gamma contexts, where all the resource annotations are zero, and you can add them pointwise. You can multiply them by a scalar from the resource the resource semi-ring, and all of the sensible distributive laws apply. So things like rho plus rho prime of, so my usual metavariable for a gamma context will be delta. Delta, all of that sort of stuff. Okay. The marvelous thing about gamma contexts forming an R module is that you can split a gamma context into by subdividing the resources associated with each variable rather than by throwing away or reordering the variables. So we're in with a fighting chance of dependent types still working. That was always the problem. Let me remind you of why. Well, what people used to do, what people still do, when it comes to combining linear and dependent types, in the same system, they tend to have separate pie types and lollipops. So the rule, and they will sort of split contexts between,
actually feel like changing color simply because this is an example of something else rather than the system that I'm currently talking about. So introduce in a different color then erase. So yeah, split context. There's an intuitionistic part, gamma. There's a linear part, delta. Types in delta may depend on things in gamma. The order in gamma matters. The order in delta doesn't. No types may depend on things in delta. And then the application rule is typically that if for the lollipop, that the application rule for the pie is this. That's the typical situation. So notice that when you have a dependently typed function, all of the linear context gets the dependently typed application, or an application of a dependently typed function. All of the resources go in the function. The argument, which is going to end up in the type, must be built only over the intuitionistic context. And if you think about, if you wanted to try and do something like this, right, so the problem is that S, big S, has to be a type in both places for this to make sense. And if you're splitting up your linear context into two chunks, with some variables going one way and other variables going another way, if big S can depend on the variables in the linear part of the context, then this just doesn't, this is going to make sense. So if you're actually saying some of the variables go one way and the other variables go the other way, you've got a problem doing dependently typed functions. This is why you can't have a linear lollipop if you're cutting up the contexts into separate variables. Okay, so if instead you are keeping all of the variables, but cutting up the resources associated with the variables, you stand a fighting chance. My application rule says if you have delta giving the function some type or other and delta prime, and of course being a religious person, something slightly more to say here. Well, I've given the game away. I'm going to use my module structure to split the resources I have into these things here. Right, these are, so these are delta and delta prime are both gamma contexts for some gamma. That is why I'm allowed to add them. And correspondingly, all the things in that gamma are in this context. Crucially, much as I did with worlds earlier, there are annotations on the context entry, and there's an annotation in the judgment. So I'm going to say, how many of this application I would like to construct and synthesize what type I get. So you say how many of each thing you've got, and you say how many of the stuff that you're building you need. Okay, so then we have to think about what happens. So if we're gonna have this many results of this application, we are gonna need to use the function that many times. So we're gonna need that many copies of the function. And then we look at this type, and it's gonna look like that. And then we're gonna get as far as saying that that type. But now we have to figure out how many of the arguments we're going to need. At which point it would be really useful to know how many copies of the input are needed to produce each output. That's to say, what is the unit price of an output in the currency of inputs. So we just make that part of the function type. Gets labeled with the unit price of an output. And then if we want row outputs, we need high row inputs. So we're really using the semi-ring structure. So then, what's going on, and why does this type make sense? And there's always the worry, like, are we when we do this substitution, you know, aren't we using little s in some interesting accountable way? Remember I said we were counting runtime copies, and these types anyway don't live at runtime. So that's fun. I should have given you, yeah, so I should, by the way, have given you the variable rule, which says if you are trying to make row copies of X, then you should have row copies of X and none of anything else. You'll notice that, so that's the key message. We never manufacture runtime copies of types in this system. All the type formation rules have a zero here. So what I'm saying is that we never need to spend runtime resources on constructing a type. It's a hilariously straightforward accounting trick. Instead of saying that I take this context and split it into two components, thus making some variables go out of scope on each side, I say, I could say, well, some variables get zero resource on each side, which means they're still available for type formation, but they're not available at runtime. So, you know, it's just that vital difference between never having heard of X and having heard of X but knowing that you haven't got any.
We actually had similar things like this, although we didn't generalize this accounting principle. We had similar problems when we were doing the coded language. We had these record types where you can take stuff out, but it was still kind of useful to know what the type was of the field you removed from the record, even though it's not in scope, so to speak, anymore.
Yeah.
You still wanted it.
Yeah.
So this is
that sort of. I figured this out in a pub. I drank a pint of beer, which was delicious. I think it was a pint of Vest Hefeweizen, brewed to German purity laws in Glasgow.
Is that even possible?
But apparently, I mean, the Bavarian woman who runs the place is not under any legal obligation to respect German purity laws, but she feels under a strong moral obligation to do so. And I looked at my empty glass mournfully, and I thought, the specification for my next beer is that it be as delicious as the last one. I cannot drink the same beer again because it's gone now, but still I can contemplate that beer when constructing the type of the next one. How is that possible? And I looked into my empty beer glass and I saw the number zero. And all of a sudden I knew what to do. that's the game. There is a corresponding erasure result that says everything which is marked with resource usage zero can be erased for runtime purposes. There's a kind of church to curry style translation where you look at the actual, you look at this product, and if it's if it's zero for either of the obvious reasons why it might be zero, then you don't actually bother generating code corresponding to the argument. And similarly, the lambda rule, which I might as well write down for completeness. Nope, this should be price. Right then, so we're trying to type check this lambda. We need row many copies of the function. So we're certainly going to have to be able to make from pi row inputs. We're going to need to be able to make row outputs. Yes, so. I wrote, this is one thing I have written a paper about. It's in Phil Wandler's Festschrift. last summer I was traveling. I went to three conferences and a summer school in the month before the pop-up deadline and a few other events in Scotland before I left for those things.
So it was exact, so.
That sort of thing. And it was, I gave, in the course of that month, I gave 8 talks, all different, all new material, whilst trying to write a pop paper. It was rejected for being incoherent and even more deranged than usual. except they couldn't say than usual because it was double blind to pretend.
I think it would be pretty hard not to identify you.
So basically, Sam Lindley, when we were running close to the Wadlerfest deadline, I still hadn't produced the thing I wanted to write about session times. I think Sam said to me, please let us have the paper about this. We'll help you fix the incoherent bit, but keep the deranged. That's just right for Phil. That's why they're there. I mean, yeah. So if your semi-ring has a one, yeah. So my favorite semi-ring is 0-1 loss, none-1 tons. That's what I call it. To get away with it properly, you need to add, it's good to add some notion of weakening that you can add sort of selectively. So basically you have a rule which says, you have an order on your contexts. You have an order on the doesn't have to be particularly well behaved. Well, it does have to be quite well behaved. Yeah. So, for example, if you got 0-1 and an infinity, well, you know how to add and multiply those things, right? If you add the 0 is less than infinity and 1 is less than infinity. What this means is if you have this many of a thing in your context, you can throw some of them away and just act like you have this many. So you'll notice if I add these two rules, if I have lots of something, then I can throw them all away, or all but one of them away. But I certainly haven't. So what's missing is 0 less than 1. So if I've got 1 of something, I can't throw it away. I mean, I can also add this if I want to go, fine. But if you just have these two, then you get 3 well-known sorts of abstraction. You get sort of, so 0 x in S arrow T is otherwise known as for all x in S arrow T, or possibly intersection x in S T. 1 x in S to T is x in S lollipop T, and then lots x in S T is I X S T. Yes. So this is the type, the dependent type of functions in which the input is consumed but in some way commemorated in the type of the output. So for example, if you want to write the function which takes a list and recycles the memory occupied by the list to make a vector whose length is the length of the original list, makes perfect sense to do that.
So when I was trying my refinement calculus thing called refinement times as well, I had this exact problem because I was trying to encode propositions about your variables, and then use the variables, so if they are linear type, suddenly you've lost the variable that you have. I tried to introduce the notion of ghost variables, so you have ghost variables, you make them equal to your original variables, but then you use them in that equality, so you can't use them anywhere else. This kept happening, and so, yeah, this neatly solves all of the problems. Thank you for this, this is very helpful.
I got certainly a nothing.
Was that the ring without negation thing? First, I didn't read it.
Yeah.
Okay.
It turned into that.
Right.
Right. I think the object of the exercise was to choose a paper title so that they wouldn't even need to get to the missing author line before then. Yeah, so there's lots still to think about in this territory. I've given you one of the linear connectives. What about the rest? Right. A tensor is hopefully boring. That's to say, how are you going to make a thing that lives in X and S tensor T of X? Well, you chop up your resources, you make a thing in S, and then no copies of that thing are needed to form the type of the thing that you build with the rest of your resources. Oh yeah, sorry. It's a thing that I should have mentioned, although it's kind of been lurking, which is that not only do gamma contexts form an R module, but valid typing derivations of a particular term form an R module. That's to say, in particular, that you can take a valid typing derivation and just pre-multiply the whole thing by zero, which says, if you can make some things from some stuff, then you can make none of the things from none of the stuff. And that's how many of the things you need to substitute for a variable in time. It works out quite neatly. Yes. So I for a while, just sort of lived with this particular semi-ring, but Stephen Dolan in Cambridge, I gave a talk about this in Cambridge, and Stephen said to me, that thing you're doing with 0, 1, and infinity You're not doing anything that's specific to an individual semi-ring in these rules, just here. But, so, if you want to do erasure of zero-weighted things, then you have to make sure that the only way two things can add up to zero is if they're both zero. Otherwise, all of a sudden, you've erased something which was only kind of measured at zero because of matter or antimatter collision. it's sort of aggressively a semi ring. But yeah, so that you can clearly then see why, given the similarity of the styles of things that are going on in these rules and the ones we had earlier,
mm-hmm.
why I would start to want not to do the meta theory twice. more to think there. Oh yeah, the connectives.
So the one thing I would notice that is different between this and the presentation you had this morning was that here you don't have quantifiers for your worlds, instead you have a multiplier.
Yeah. Right. So the thing I'm wondering is whether I am wrong to assume that these things which live in the, that are called pi in this picture are elements of R. Why should they be? Why should they not be some sort of thing that can be interpreted as a monoid homomorphism?
Yeah.
It's clear that they have to distribute properly.
Yeah.
But it's not totally clear whether they have to be the same stuff as the rows. They might just have to have a suitable sort of action on the rows.
Yeah. And then it's much closer to what you did this morning.
Having learned the hard way, that I didn't want the quantifiers to be the same sort of stuff as the worlds. Yeah, I sort of had that thought here rather sooner. Yeah, there's lots of fun stuff to look at. Other connectives. Dependent width makes some sort of sense. What this says is, if you have an element of this, then you are offering your clients two choices: either to have an unreconstructed element of S, or to have some T whose type depends on the original thing that is no longer available because you reused its resources to make this thing. So, yeah, exactly. You could offer either the list or the vector that you made from the list, whose length is the length of the list, that sort of thing. But what I do not know what the
hell is that?
I'm kind of trying to figure out what this is. By thinking that it had better be dual to that. But still kind of, yeah, dependent cat product. Yeah. Don't know what's going on there. Beginning to think about it, having some disturbing ideas. it's kind of like, to choose to build something on the left, you have to know how to make an S with your stuff. To choose to go right, you have to know how to make a T. Whose type gets instantiated with and no copies of an S that you can make with no stuff. But it's still highly asymmetric. So you have to be able to imagine something of this type, but then not make one and instead go right. Which is, I mean, well, okay, so the fact that things go bad if S happens to be the empty type, for example. What on earth is that about?
It seems like it could be okay if you made S, if you made sure S was a pointed type.
Yeah, maybe. But that's, it's still, yeah, there was kind of, nothing of that worry here. Still trying to figure out what's gonna give there. I mean, possibly I'm just in. There's a thing I haven't unlearned yet, and I'm trying to think of this as a co-product, but it really isn't. Anything else to do with this? Oh, there is one other thing to say, which is kind of how I got into this. It's all Phil's fault, but a bit Phil, a bit Sam. One time, Phil did his Propositions as Sessions tour. 3 t-shirts, what have you. And I was chatting to Sam afterwards and said, well, if you're not doing session types with dependent types, you can't possibly be doing it right. Sam took great pleasure in reporting this opinion to Phil. At which point, Phil became curious as to what dependent session types might be like. And, since session types are, but so Phil's thinking, and it sounds sort of plausible, is that session types are linear types. So dependent session types should be dependent linear types. And okay, it's difficult because people don't know what dependent linear types are, or plenty of people think that this is as good as it gets. Well, actually, yeah, not so many. There are plenty of people who think that this is a good thing to do, and only some of them think that this is as good as it gets. And then, so you've got people like Nick Benton and Neil Krishnaswamy, whose rules these are, doing doing functional reactive programming in this sort of situation, and you've got you also have Frank Kenning doing dependent session types, where you can't have any dependency on sort of channel types, but you can on signal types. So again, sort of same idea that it's just the intuitionistic values that you can have dependent types depending on. And there's something in the same spirit here. You know, all I'm doing is ensuring that everything that exists in the resource sort of a world has a completely intuitionistic zero resourced counterpart, which is the thing that actually instantiates the variable in the dependent types. So, you know, and somehow that's the statically conceptualized version of the thing rather than the runtime resource sensitive version of the thing that stands in. So, the sort of type. The zero resource thing stands in for the runtime object at the type level. So it's just not, you get full dependent types just by ensuring that everything has a type level stand in, as opposed to everything can move, get copied into a type. That was a useful thought. But you know, bashing away at these things, yes, so the, trying to figure out what linear dependent types were, and then getting this far and realizing that although these are linear dependent types, they are not session types. They are too rich to be session types. So, I mean, you might sort of think of the lollipop as a session type, meaning receive a channel that behaves like S, and then behave like T. But the things that can substitute for X are, the things that we're typing here are really the processes that do those communications rather than the signals. So what gets substituted for the bound variables in these types are not, the processes that are doing the interaction rather than the signals that are being exchanged in the interaction. Kind of the idea of session types is that later parts of the protocol are determined by earlier exchanged signals, not depending on the agents who are exchanging the signals. And once you start having types depending on stuff, then whether they depend on the agents or whether they depend on the signals gives you completely different stuff. So so the moral of the story really is that when you're building a dependent type theory, in a very literal way, you need to know what you're talking about. Because look, you're using a variable to stand for some stuff, and then the type of the variable type checks some stuff, and then the actual stuff gets substituted for the variable. It's not just a kind of formal game. You have to have some idea what these S's mean in order to say why it could possibly make sense to substitute them for a bound variable in type. The thing with session types is that it's that there's a choice of which are the things that the session types are talking about. They can be talking about the channels on which signals are being exchanged. They can talk about the processors which are exchanging the signals. Here, well, my point is that they can also just talk about the signals which are being exchanged. And which of these things you think the types are talking about and which of these things you're substituting for the bound variables is going to have a profound impact on what kind of type system you end up with.
Another one of my stories.